kids. So this week's Torah portion is called Tasriya, or She Conceives. It starts with Leviticus 12, which discusses the laws for women after childbirth. Now the Haftarah section is about the prophet Elisha. As I read about Elisha and his predecessor Elijah, or Eliyah, I see several prophetic similarities between them and Yeshua and John the Baptist. Now, I like to use the more Hebraic pronunciation of Eliyah just because Elijah sounds so much like Elisha to me. So here's some support for Eliyah being prophetic of John the Baptist. Malachi 4:5, "Behold, I will send you Eliyah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of Yahweh. And he will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the hearts of the children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the earth with a curse." Now, an angel cited this prophecy in Luke when talking about John the Baptist. Chapter 1:17, "He will also go before him in the spirit and power of Eliyah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Here's some further support. Matthew 11:13, "For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John the Baptist. And if you are willing to receive it, he is Eliyah who is to come. He who has ears to hear, let him hear." Also, Matthew 17:12, "But I say to you that Eliyah has come already, and they did not know him, but did to him whatever they wished. Likewise, the Son of Man is also about to suffer at their hands." Then the disciples understood that he spoke to them of John the Baptist. Now here are some passages that lead me to think of Elisha being prophetic of Yeshua. 2 Kings 2:9, "And so it was, when they had crossed over, that Eliyah said to Elisha, 'Ask, what may I do for you before I am taken away from you?' Elisha said, 'Please let a double portion of your spirit be upon me.' Elisha did receive the double portion. Similarly, Yeshua was greater than John the Baptist. For example, John said in John 3:28, 'You yourselves bear me witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but I have been sent before him. He must increase, but I must decrease.' So just like Eliyah came before Elisha, John came before Jesus. There are more things about Elisha that seem to me to be prophetic of Yeshua. I could probably have put together an hour-long study on this, and I bet Daniel could get 10 hours out of this topic. But I have to try to fit into 10 minutes, so I'll just mention some of these. Okay, there's miracles changing water. Elisha purified a water source by putting salt in it. Yeshua turned water into wine at the wedding feast. Miracles to help make payments. Elisha made a widow's oil supply multiply to pay her debt. Yeshua had Peter catch a fish out of the sea and take money out of its mouth to pay a tax. They raised someone from death. Elisha revived the dead son of a Shunammite woman. Yeshua revived Lazarus, who had been dead for 4 days. Fed a multitude with a little. And this account is in this week's Haftarah portion. Elisha fed 100 men with 20 barley loaves and had some left over. Yeshua twice fed thousands of men with less loaves and had food left over. He miraculously brought something out of water. Elisha made iron float to the water surface. Yeshua allowed his disciples to catch a multitude of fish after catching nothing that night. They miraculously escaped a multitude. Elisha was attacked by Syrians, but Yahweh struck them with blindness. Yeshua was going to be thrown off a cliff, but he passed through the midst of the crowd. They raised others from death after they died. Elisha revived a dead man when he touched Elisha's bones. And now Peter raised Tabitha or Dorcas from the dead. And Peter said in Acts 3:16 that the healing he did was in the name of Yeshua. And of course, Jesus did even better than Elisha by rising from the dead himself. There are probably more, but here is the majority of this week's Haftarah portion. 2 Kings 5:1. "Now Naaman, commander of the army of the king of Syria, was a great and honorable man in the eyes of his master, because by him Yahweh had given victory to Syria. He was also a mighty man of valor, but a leper. And the Syrians had gone out on raids and had brought back captive a young girl from the land of Israel. She waited on Naaman's wife. Then she said to her mistress, "If only my master were with the prophet who is in Samaria, for he would heal him of his leprosy." Now Naaman was a Syrian, a Gentile. He went to see Elisha in verse 9. Then verse 10, "And Elisha sent a messenger to Naaman, saying, 'Go and wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored to you, and you shall be clean.' But Naaman became furious and went away and said, 'Indeed, I said to myself, he will surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of Yahweh, his God, and wave his hand over the place and heal the leprosy. Are not the Abana and the Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean?' So he turned and went away in a rage." Now Naaman felt disrespected that Elisha didn't give him more attention. Verse 13, "And his servants came near and spoke to him and said, 'My father, if the prophet had told you to do something great, would you not have done it? How much more then when he says to you, wash and be clean?' So he went down and dipped 7 times in the Jordan, according to the saying of the man of God. And his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean." So Naaman was made clean by God through Elisha. Now let's look at when Yeshua mentioned Naaman. Luke 4:24. "Then Yeshua said, 'Assuredly, I say to you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. But I tell you truly, many widows were in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months. And there was a great famine throughout all the land. But to none of them was Elijah sent except to Zarephath, in the region of Sidon, to a woman who was a widow. And many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elisha the prophet, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian." So now this was after Yeshua read from Isaiah in the synagogue on the Sabbath and said it was talking about him. "And after he said this, the others in the synagogue tried to throw Jesus off a cliff, but failed. They were upset because Yeshua pointed out that while many needed help in Israel, God's prophets healed a couple Gentiles. Just like the Jews that rebelled against Jesus, the Israelites had issues rebelling against God during the time of Eliah and Elisha. Those prophets reaching out to the Gentiles then was prophetic of how Yeshua reached out to the Gentiles through Paul and the apostles after they were rejected by the majority of the Jews. Yeshua also healed lepers, like the account recorded in Matthew 8, Mark 1, and Luke 5. Now back to the Haftarah. 2 Kings 5:15. "And Naaman returned to the man of God, he and all his aides, and came and stood before him. And he said, 'Indeed, now I know that there is no God in all the earth, except in Israel. Now, therefore, please take a gift from your servant.' But he said, 'As Yahweh lives, before whom I stand, I will receive nothing.' And he urged him to take it, but he refused. So Naaman said, 'Then, if not, please let your servant be given 2 mule loads of earth, for your servant will no longer offer either burnt offering or sacrifice to other gods, but to Yahweh.' Naaman was humbled after his earlier anger and repented. He turned to Yahweh the same way other Gentiles since then have turned to Yahweh when they repented. This also reminds me of another miraculous healing by Yeshua. Luke 7:2, "And a certain centurion's servant who was dear to him was sick and ready to die. So when he heard about Jesus, he sent elders of the Jews to him, pleading with him to come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they begged him earnestly, saying that the one for whom he should do this was deserving, for he loves our nation and has built us a synagogue." Here we again have a Gentile reaching out to the God of Israel for healing. "Then Jesus went with them, and when he was already not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to him, saying to him, 'Lord, do not trouble yourself, for I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. Therefore, I did not even think myself worthy to come to you. But say the word, and my servant will be healed.'" This Gentile has the opposite attitude of Naaman, who is proud. The centurion instead approached Yeshua with extreme humility. "For I also am a man placed under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to one, 'Go,' and he goes. And to another, 'Come,' and he comes. And to my servant, 'Do this,' and he does it." When Jesus heard about these things, he marveled at him and turned around and said to the crowd that followed him, I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. And those who were sent, returning to the house, found the servant well who had been sick. So just like Elisha wasn't present when Naaman got healed, Jesus didn't have to interact with the servant to heal him. Now, just a thought. I wonder if when the centurion heard about Yeshua, like it said in verse 3, that he heard about Yeshua cleansing lepers. And I wonder if this centurion, who had such a good relationship with the Jews, knew their scripture and knew about the leper Naaman. So he avoided making Naaman's mistake of getting angry when Elisha didn't come by proactively telling Jesus he didn't have to come. So this is another prophetic example of Yeshua in the Tanakh and an example of how we can learn from the mistakes others made. Many of us aren't Jewish by blood, but we see Yeshua has taken care of and healed Gentiles long before he even walked on the earth. And we also see his power goes beyond the physical. Just like there wasn't anyone physically there for Naaman or the centurion's servant, we don't need Jesus physically present for him to have a powerful impact on our lives. Let's keep this in mind as we strive to walk out the same kind of faith the centurion had. Shabbat shalom.